It's Wednesday morning, you're on London's number one, just gone 9 on the 8th of September, Capital FM. Among your headlines still to come this hour, a man who eats 3 packets of cigarettes a day, and why Japanese girls are wearing electric underpants. Yeah, line's still open for Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? What a fine show that is. Line's still open, 15 questions. You could win £1 million. They're getting closer. 09-002-44-44-44. It's Wednesday, Capital Breakfast. This is Ronan.
Hello?
Oh, hi, can I speak to Perry Paul, please?
This is Perry Paul speaking.
Oh, hi there, Perry. My name's Sophie. I'm calling from the television show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Hello, Sophie.
Hello there. I'm very pleased to let you know you gave one of the 10 closest answers to the question we asked you. my eardrum.
I'm joking.
Well done. Are you okay there?
Yes, I'm fine.
It's a lot to take in, isn't it, within 5 minutes?
It's a lot to take in.
Okay, that's great. Now, can I take your age, please, and your date of birth?
It's my birthday today. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Bye. I don't believe it. Right. What am I going to wear?
Okay, Jen, right, question number one, here it comes. We'd like you to play this one, please, for 100 quid. Otherwise, it wouldn't be much of a game. The Archbishop of Canterbury is a leading what? Churchman.
We always do this practice day at the beginning of each series before we get in the studio. It's mainly for me. Well, the first series ever, it was for all of us, just to get me into the whole mechanics of it with the computer and all that. So it's just getting me back on course in a very relaxed way.
Ring, ring.
Hello?
Hello, is that Paul?
Yes.
Hello, it's Chris Tarrant here from ITV's Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Oh, hello, Chris. How are you?
Well, I'm fine. I've got Jenny here at the moment. Now, I know you can't see a television. Mostly because we're sitting in your lounge. Now, the next voice you hear will be Jenny's. She will tell you the question and 4 possible answers. Okay, do you understand it, Mr. Smith? Because you sound a bit of a thick sod to me.
Paul Smith is Millionaire's executive producer, and it was to him that David Briggs first brought the idea of a blockbuster quiz show.
I think it evolved a lot to do with my relationship with Chris, in that I'd done a lot on radio with him, in which we'd use some of the parts of Millionaire in different competitions, and I did a lot with him on the radio about pushing people's emotions fairly close to the limit. And I think the combination of those two things was somewhere in the genesis of the beginning of Millionaire in my mind.
It's the right answer. You've got another!
I suppose on average we made one a day. Wow. On average. Well, actually, Sunday afternoon when I made this particular call, we made quite a few. Because we'd recorded... Cheers. We'd recorded a few, and we were sitting down watching them, weren't we? And we raised a glass to Chris Tarrant, and I said, I've got to ring. Anyway, and now I've got to ring my mother. And I'm going all the way. I have to tell you, family decision already been made. I am not coming home with 64,000, and I'm not coming home with 125,000. It's all or nothing, I'm afraid.
Good job. Bluff me away for another one.
I think a lot of people are amazed at my schedule at the moment. It is complete madness. I crawl away from Elstree at about midnight-ish, and I'm up again at 5:15 the next morning. I'm on the radio at 6. It's just the way I've lived for so long, I think. It's a bit like being a band on tour at the moment. I'm literally doing the show, crashing out to a hotel in the middle of town, getting up, doing the radio and going back to Elstree. But I sleep. When I get to Elstree, I have an hour or so. Yesterday, I actually went fishing. It was great. I actually dived out fishing for a couple of hours. Just a bit to get away from phones and, you know, rehearsals and talking to the guys about the show, whatever. I just need to switch off a bit. And it's only a short, sharp chunk. It's like 12 manic days and nights and early mornings, whatever. And then it's sort of back to normal, and it calms down, and then we do it again, you know, in about 3 months' time, whatever.
But each night, when the show's on air, Chris Tarrant puts a contestant on the rack and gently turns the screw.
If you go with him and he's wrong, it has cost you £93,000.
It's all about seeing people making life-changing decisions right before your eyes. And the only way that you could create the tension and the drama is to add the money. And that's all the money does. It just makes it a life-changing decision.
I'm going to go for it. Heads.
Sure you want to play?
See, heads.
Final answer.
Final answer.
You had £125,000. You just won a quarter of...
Thanks, Chris.
This is a recording for Jane Saffield on 1737. Well, you answered the telephone question correctly, and our computer's now selected you, along with around 100 others, to go onto a shortlist for the show.
From the outset, we had to determine how can we give away £1 million as a top prize in a game show. And there is no network's budget that would support being able to give the sort of money that we are giving away and the production costs of making a programme. So there is a method whereby contestants who wish to participate call a premium phone line. It costs them a maximum of £1. When they ring this number, they're asked a general knowledge question, one of 40 different ones that they can be asked in any one day. If they get it correct, they are then asked on which particular day they would like to play. We then call back 100 of those people that are chosen truly at random, but from around the country. They're chosen from the different call centres that exist around the whole of the United Kingdom that make up the network of 5,200 lines that are available to call at any time at all when the programme is on the air and the 10 days previous to it. And we ask those 100 people what we call a nearest to question.
How many seats are there in the US House of Representatives?
And the 10 that get it nearest are those that are invited to come on the programme.
Now, today what's going to happen is that this afternoon we're going to do a rehearsal.
Yeah.
And in that time I'm going to take you through all the things that happen in the show. You have a chance to do Fastest Finger first. You have a chance to sit in the chair with Chris and answer a couple of questions. And you'll see how all the cameras and the lights move and everything like that. And the idea of this is, so at the end of that period, you know everything that's going to happen in the studio and the programme tonight. The only thing that's different is that we have an audience in there, which are very quiet. And we do change the questions from the rehearsal to the... What I do like to do is kind of early in the day when they're first here, just plant a couple of thoughts in their mind.
All right, okay.
And we chat a little bit about Chris and a bit about phoning their friends and things like that. It's to sort of get them into the feel of the show and what's going to happen.
Okay, it's Fastest Finger first. This is how it works. In a moment, a question will appear on your screens with four possible answers. Whoever puts the four answers in the correct order in the fastest time will be first to play for £1 million. Silence in the audience, please.
With this show, we don't meet the people until they arrive at lunchtime on the day they are to do the show. Most of them would never have been in a television studio before, so it is a very short period in which they have got to be familiarised with everything to do with the show, how to play it, so that they're given the best chance when they actually get on.
OK, let's see who got it right. But let's see who got it right in the fastest time.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sonia, can I just tell you something?
Yes.
This is just a rehearsal.
I know!
I think they're always much better when they've been through rehearsal because they know how awful it is or how not awful it is. But I like to sort of just get them into the mood of the show and get them thinking about what they're going to do and how they're going to do it and what their aspirations are. And finally, I like to try and say to them all, look, you've come from Timbuktu, you know, Scotland or round the corner in Wembley or wherever you've come from. For crying out loud, just enjoy yourself here. Because if you have a good day, at least if you take some money home away with you, then that's bonus. But just have a good time with us, because it's a kind of fun day out. I think most people enjoy it, and that's what it should be.
Before rehearsals, contestants are handed a questionnaire and invited to dream. Their answers give Chris a useful insight into their personalities.
If you won £1 million tonight, what would you spend it on?
The only really rash thing I can think of is a Ferrari.
Yeah. Two new front teeth.
Well, I've got a nice car, and it does me well. The only thing I would do is change it for a diesel.
Well, that's easy. I've always been interested in space. I'd like to be the first man to go to Mars.
Ideal holiday destination. Great Barrier. Tropical island.
My husband can go diving with the sharks.
Thanks.
and I can watch the lifeguards walk by.
With Pierce Brosnan. No, so I could be shaken and stirred.
I think a lot of people are quite surprised how determined I am to do the afternoon rehearsals and sort of be very involved with the whole thing almost from the moment the contestants arrive. To me, it's actually essential. I really need to know these people. I mean, they are complete strangers. They are the most extraordinary cross-section. And we just sit down, and I'll know quite a lot of information about them, about the kind of person they are, about their background or whatever. But I don't really know what they're going to be like. I mean, people amaze you night after night with, you know, the way they play, the extent of their knowledge, the limitations of their knowledge, or just how they are, how manic they become, how dire they are, or whatever. So I just feel I need to be quite prepared for that myself before I go on the show. So I need to know that, you know, if that person has won Fastest Finger, they'll probably be like this.
Yes! Sonia Davis! Five for Yes, good. Yeah, Sonia, I don't know how to break this to you. You haven't actually won anything yet.
Oh, God. Oh, Vinnie Stender's
brilliant. Is that right? Don't you watch EastEnders? No. You don't watch Coronation Street?
No, I only watch Coronation Street. I don't watch television.
You'll be all right. Just be calm. Just
thank
get your brain
you.
Together.
Okay.
Trust me, I'll talk you through it. But just okay. Be calm.
Thanks.
Get your head together. I think a lot of people think that I'm some kind of sadist, you know, that I'm really putting these people through hell. I'm not. I'm not doing it on purpose. I'm stretching them, and I'm making them very, you know, very, very sure that they really want to play this answer, that that is definitely the answer they want to play.
I think it's Hyacinth. Do you know?
I'm not in it. If you give me a wrong answer, you do drop 15,000. It's a big drop. But if you get it right, you double your money for 32,000. Guaranteed, and I'll write you out a cheque on the spot.
I'll take the money.
Give her a big hand. Sonia goes away with £16,000.
One of the keys to millionaire success is what David Briggs likes to call shoutability.
Oh, shoutability is that everybody watching the show is encouraged and can't stop themselves shouting at the television. It's an opportunity where the audience can be involved, actively involved with the programme. You're not a passive player, you are actively involved. And the lovely thing is that you're involved now as families, as groups of people. It's something that is an interactive television programme, virtually.
B-D-A-C. Were we the quickest?
As the questions are asked and the contestant is thinking about the answer, millions of people are sitting at home screaming at the television, the answer is B, quite obviously, and they all know it. And that shoutability.
It's worth £1,000. And at this moment, every child in your school is shouting the answer at the television, sir. It's worth £1,000.
Well, I never watch it, but I think it's A, friends, and...
If you give me a wrong answer, you go home with nothing.
Yeah. I think I can go with A.
For £1,000, you send to me, friends?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good man, it's the right answer. You've got £1,000.
Coming up in part two, how some technical magic turned millionaire into a hit and how Perry Poole prepares for her big night.
Christmas with Jacob's Ritz.
Who Wants to Be a Millionaire only reached the screen after months of preparation and two pilot programmes. But from the very beginning, it had the enthusiastic support of ITV's head of entertainment, Claudia Rosencrantz.
Paul Smith rang up and asked if he could come in to pitch a show. And he said, I don't want to send you anything first, I just want to come in and do it. I promise you, you know, it would be worth it. And it really was just such an incredibly exciting pitch. I mean, I was very, very excited by the show.
However, there were aspects of the programme that worried ITV's director of programmes, David Liddiment.
I was persuaded that the show was a great idea, but I was nervous of some of the mechanics of the show. For example, I was worried that while it was a great idea that we gave people the question before they decided whether they wanted to answer it or not, to give the answers as well struck me as quite dangerous, as, you know, we're talking about the top prize of £1 million, and I didn't want to see the show or ITV or Celador bankrupt. So Paul knew that I had some nervousness about that. So he came to see me to persuade me that I had no need to worry. And in fact, the way he did it was to make me play the game.
He said, how much money have you got on you? And David said, £210. That's all he had in his wallet. And he said, all right, I'll take an IOU off you for £250 so you can play the first round. And so we started playing it. And I was his phone a friend, and I was hopeless.
On the second question, I was faced with what every contestant on that show is faced with, which is, do I really know the answer to this question? Because if I don't, I'm going to lose all this money. And that graphically illustrated to me just how clever the kind of mechanisms of the show were.
Now, we're going to find out which one of you is going to be the next player to play for £1 million on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. This is how
we actually made two pilots prior to the show going on air, and the best way of describing it is that it reflected the basic concept exceptionally well, but in presentation terms, it didn't have any of the production values that exist in the show now.
Which of these countries has a Union Jack on its flag? Canada, USA, Ireland, Australia?
I had viewed the pilot over the weekend, which, when analysed, really came down to three main areas: that the sound was poor and that we had to improve the music, that we had to adjust the set, which was much too bright and glossy, and that we needed to deal with the lighting. It was these three elements that were holding back the show from being the 1990s television programme.
Right, here we go. Thank you, Mike.
Originally, somebody else had written the music, which they weren't quite happy with. So they thought, well, that isn't right, we need something else. The brief was that it's got to be very, very dramatic. And I just said, well, if you want it to have tension, you need to bed it all with music. You need to have something going on underneath the questions all the time. Well, it was Paul suggested, it's something like a heartbeat, he said, you know, so dum dum.
Once the new dramatic music was in place, it was time to tackle the lighting.
Paul said, well, we think we got the show, but I need more, and there's no atmosphere. And clearly Paul wanted something, but I didn't know what I could give him, because, you know, we were dealing with sort of mastermind. And then he said, well, beams, I need beams. And I said, but you can't, Paul, because if we have beams, we've got to have smoke. If we have smoke, it thins the pictures, and it's not a rock and roll show. And then I thought, let me just think about this.
Right.
And Paul had been generous and said, I'll back you, do whatever you want. You can spend whatever you want. I just want you to throw away conventional lighting and give me something that's completely different. So that was the bond. That was the last piece. The music and the lighting sort of got together, and it all worked from that point onwards and is still being improved on.
It could have been the biggest turkey of all time, this show.
Tonight and for the next 10 nights, you'll be watching British quiz show history. For the first time on UK TV, we have a top prize available of £1 million, and it could be won here tonight.
Before that first night, I mean, all of us were actually quite terrified, and I was in here in the dressing room sort of getting ready to go on. And normally I'm fairly together, and I sort of, you know, as long as I know exactly what I'm doing, I don't get that nervous. But at about 7:15, about a quarter of an hour to go, I just said to everybody, can you leave me? And they're going, oh, yeah, but we'll stay. And I was going, no, no, like, you know, my manager, my wife, everybody who's around is having a drink and chatting. I just got them all out. I just had a very sort of quiet 10 minutes in here. I thought, what am I doing?
Now, all we have to do now is find out which of our 10 contestants will be the first to play for a possible cool £1 million.
I don't think that I realised just what a good show it was and how much it had achieved what we'd set out to do until the second programme. That particular night we had a rollover contestant called Rachel Mendes da Costa, and It was quite the most exciting and dramatic piece of television, and it has rarely been matched in the rest of the programmes that we've had.
What's the name of the cafe owner played by Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca? The cafe owner. Sam. Kyle. Jack. Or Rick?
I'm going to use a lifeline.
Okay.
I totally and utterly got involved in what this girl was going through. And it was incredibly emotional for her. It was incredibly dramatic and incredibly traumatic. Because she was being faced with these agonizing decisions that she was only just coping with. The greatest one being calling her father. He was at a hotel in Scotland.
Which English county has a border with only one other? Devon, Norfolk, Cornwall or Kent?
I have no idea. I'm sorry, Rachel, I can't help you on geography. Give me again.
Devon, Norfolk, Cornwall or Kent?
Devon, Norfolk.
Dad, help me.
The drama was intense. And when we went to the commercial break, I ran from the computer room to the production gallery where Martin was directing, and I put my arms around him and I said to him, you're directing the best drama on television at this moment.
Suppose you'd answered for £16,000, which one of those four counties would you have said has got a border with only one other?
Cornwall.
I'm not even going to tell you what would have happened if it didn't. You would have won £16,000.
It was a masterstroke of scheduling by David Liddiment to run the programme on consecutive nights.
Well, I was excited about the prospect of the show by this sense of event, this sense of occasion that I thought it could have. And I just thought by running it in a strip across consecutive nights, that would give it an even greater sense of occasion. And so it's proved.
There was a question on TV yesterday about books.
Yeah?
Ask me a book question.
Oh, gosh. Name two novels by Dickens.
Where's Olivia? Great Expectations.
Yeah.
And The Christmas Carol? Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Oliver Twist, yeah?
Christmas Carol, Oliver Twist. Nicholas Nickleby.
Your curiosity shop?
Yeah. Oh, got all that?
Got it. All I need now is someone to ask me a question about it tonight.
We have a team of question setters who are locked away in various parts of the country, who write questions which all come to London, and in a nutshell I then edit them. And then, when all that's done, and we have 2,500 questions ready, Paul Smith and I go away to a secret destination and sit in a room for 5 days, and we review every question. And we reckon that we set a level that then is the same for everybody. It may be high for some people, it may be low for other people, but it's the same.
Which members of the armed forces wear light blue helmets and berets?
The computer then automatically sorts them by level, and in any stack of 15 questions, it will automatically ensure that you don't have repetition of certain subjects or repetition of certain sorts of questions. And it does all that and then just spews out a stack which comes up on Chris's desk.
The forint is the unit of currency of which country? Chile? Hungary?
I think he does know.
Cuba?
Oh, no, maybe he doesn't.
Or Peru?
Chris, I'm going to take the money.
Think about it. Couldn't be.
That's why you were smiling. I thought he was smiling because he knows it.
I wish I did, but I'm not greedy. I'm going to take the money.
OK, give him a big hand. Simon Murray goes away. It's 64,000.
Hello.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Pleased to meet you.
Hello.
I decided my strategy the first time I phoned up. I'm going to go all the way. Now, I know everybody said to me, you won't do it. And they may well all be right, but seriously, I want to go home at the end of the day with what I came with, which is damn good time. And if I make any money, that's great. But I really want to go all the way. I want to hit a million.
The amazing success of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire has generated interest from TV companies around the world. So far, 51 countries have bought the show, and nearly all of them come here to Britain to see how the original Millionaire is made.
When we got into the third or the fourth show of the first series, we started to get calls into our offices. Holland are interested, Belgium are interested, Denmark's been on the phone, Australia's on the phone. They all want to buy the format, not the program, the format. They want to produce the program themselves in their own countries. And the most significant one has been the States. America is the home of television game shows, and it is very rare for Britain to export in the opposite direction. And they have embraced this, and it's been a huge success.
All right, everybody, thank you very much, and welcome to night five of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Welcome to Wwtbam Millionaire.
Welcome bij weer een aflevering van Wie wordt Multimillionair.
Finale, letzte Abend von Wer wird Millionär.
Und wir haben one of the conditions that we have is they have to use the music. The set has to be the same, because we know that it's right. Now, we allow modifications for cultural differences, and I can't determine that until a particular application is made from one country or another who says, look, for whatever reasons we need to do this or we need to do that, is it okay? But they are required to ask us.
They're about to start making phone calls. They've only just learned where they're coming from. They can be coming from anywhere around the country. And these guys are magic. They can book a plane, a train, cars, taxis, whatever is needed, buses, and get everybody here by midday tomorrow.
All great ideas for quiz games or format shows on television, the ideas are always very simple, but I always liken them to the face of a watch, which is a simple idea, two hands and 12 numbers. But behind that, behind the face, are all the workings. And, you know, this show is a Swiss watch.
£8,000 you got. Do you want to play for 16?
Yeah, and I'll say A.
Saying Jamaica?
Mm-hmm.
Your final answer?
Yeah.
You've got 16 grand. It seems to me that the best winners are women. They just give so much more. They are very emotional. They just show everything on their face. The problem with men, they're just so worried about, you know, I mustn't look silly, I mustn't sort of show emotion, I don't know, it's a male thing that we're not allowed to show emotion if we can possibly help it. You just won £16,000. But there is a kind of guy that I really like. They have a great attitude that says, I'm here, it's probably the best chance in my life. You're only on this planet once, and let's go for it.
Give me a 50-50, please.
Okay, computer, take away two wrong answers. Please leave Davey just the right answer and the one remaining wrong answer.
The makeup was perfect, but you didn't see my back. Well, the water was running down. I was sweat, sorry. My right hand was a constant fidget, and was very nervous.
That was the two I wanted, one of them to go. I'll take the money.
And he was like dead in the water. It was like, oh, well, never mind, take the money, you know, whatever. And he suddenly went,
ah, why worry? Go on, go on the sharks. Go on, that's it.
Oh,
that's good enough.
I thought, if £1,000 is a bonus, I come with nothing anyway. And to 16,000, yeah, that's even better. And I thought, well, if I go home 1,000, I've got a couple of bob to spend, you know. If I win more, albeit.
It's £15,000 if you're wrong, you know that? You've got, yeah, 16,
yeah,
you can take.
Doesn't matter, you know, it's only money.
You knew that he was really draining, you know, the bottom of his resources. He was just going for it, and it was incredible to watch. You're going to play?
Yeah, I'm going to play.
Final answer, B?
B.
You just won £32,000!
I don't believe that the show is about winning £1 million at all. If it was, the show would have died after the second run. And the fact is, it is about people under pressure, how they respond. Television is one of the few things that you can show life-size on a television screen is a human face. You can look at a television screen, see a close-up of somebody, you know whether they're lying, whether they're uncomfortable, and in this particular show, it's like Mastermind, it's all about that big close-up of people under pressure. Masterminds sustained all those years, and what the prize was a piece of cut glass at the end of it. It is about the drama. How do human beings in that goldfish bowl, how do they respond? And the show is brilliant at creating drama.
Which Western character was played on screen by Jay Silverheels?
I think after the first two or three questions, you relax a bit more on the chair. And I think what I tried to do was block everything else out, which is one of the hardest things to do, and concentrate on Chris. So it's only me and Chris there.
It's your call. You've got £8,000. If you get it wrong, you've dropped
£7,000. So, Tonto.
You just won £16,000.
Every time I answered a question correctly, it meant one more bill was out of the way. You know, it's one credit card gone. Yes, you know. It's the weight off your shoulders, so that's why I was getting so worked up.
The money or risk everything. That's the dilemma facing Perry Poole in part three.
Double your money and try to get rich. Double your money without any hitch. Double your money, it's your lucky day.
Now here we come, Mary. The first question is for a pound. If Michael Miles went down the mine, would he take his pick?
Well, I expect he would.
Fivepence.
No, cost me 2 and 6 on the tube.
Did it? £5 then. You've got
no,
to...
No, no.
You've got a return fare then.
Ah, we can't have a drink after, can we?
All right, 7 and 6 pence.
No.
A pound?
No.
£14?
No.
That made you think of it, didn't it? Ah, yeah. £14 for the Keep Fit group.
No.
£14, 10, 15,
no.
19.
No.
What shall you do? Take the money away for the box. £19.
No.
£29. No. She's going to take the money. Oh, all right.
I think it's in the classic tradition of double your money or take your pick. I just think this show demonstrates how far we've come in terms of production values, in terms of not shortchanging the audience in terms of the thought and the structure that goes into the show. It's just another quiz game, you know, in that folder marked, you know, 60 years of television, 60 years of quiz games. But it just shows how sophisticated television production has to be today to in order to grip an audience.
I think Millionaire probably is perfect television in of its kind. I don't see how it could be improved. It's just something that is so simple and yet so gripping, you can't miss an episode.
Which Christian festival falls on January the 6th? Epiphany, Transfiguration, All Souls, Holy Innocents.
I mean, Tarrant, sometimes he annoys you so much. He gets under your skin the way he persecutes these poor sods. They've actually got the question right, and yeah. You confident with that?
You've got £16,000, you could take it. You could still play a 50-50, you could still phone a friend.
You want to get hold of him and slap him around the face with a fish or something, don't you? Because but I mean, that's part of the drama, that's part of the excitement of it, the fact that he's going to wind you up.
Well, I'll see the audience.
The first night of the series, the audience cost a man £7,000. The night before last, if they'd gone with the audience, he would have won £500,000. I do not have the answers on my screen. There are 2,500 or more questions in the computer per series. And there's no way I'm sitting here with the answer. It, you know, literally, when they make their final answer, which is why we go through this routine of, is that your final answer? When they say yes, that's the point at which I actually know the answer.
No, you've got to give me a bit going, haven't you? Epiphany.
Final answer, Epiphany?
Yes.
You had £16,000. This audience have just made you worth at least £32,000.
Oh, yes.
When Perry Poole arrives at the studios, her first task is to check that her phone-a-friends are standing by, ready to help her win £1 million.
Lynn, it's Perry here. How are you? I'm phoning from Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, and I just need to confirm one or two points so that you can be my very best friend tonight if I need to phone you.
We choose to tape the programme one day prior to when it is to be aired. So a programme that you are likely to view on a Wednesday is recorded on a Tuesday evening. Now, it gives us a lot of advantages, but specifically, when they opt to call one of their five phone friends.
I'll phone a friend.
OK, who are you going to phone?
I'll phone Barbara.
She's in Leicester, my mother-in-law.
That person knows that their friend is currently playing on the show because a researcher has called them and told them to stand by,
Barbara,
that they may be called. But they can't watch the television and the program on it because it's not being aired till the following day. And therefore, quite genuinely, they only have the 30 seconds in which to assist their friend that's appearing on the program.
Kinder Scout is the highest point in which county? Hampshire, Lancashire, Devon, or Derbyshire?
Definitely Derbyshire.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, Di.
Bye.
Bye.
I think people understand better how to play the game now, but I don't think it's been that much of a benefit for them. I mean, because at the end of the day, you've got to know a little about a lot, not a lot about a little. And so the more academically qualified people who come in and are brilliant in one area sadly don't know who Bart Simpson's mum is. And that's where it all falls down, because the questions are incredibly diverse. They know how to use their lifeline slightly better.
Perry.
They probably have a better idea of the sorts of questions that are going to come up. And in the middle of it all, you get these wild, wonderful people who come in probably not having studied any or thought about how to play, and they just go for fun, and they're here for a laugh, and they're great, and they do quite well sometimes.
I'm going to enjoy it tonight.
No.
If tonight is anything like today, it's going to be the best night of my life. Good luck, everybody. And cue applause. And cue Chris. And go sit.
Now, fastest finger first. I'm going to give the contestants a question, as always, four possible answers. Whoever gets them in the correct order in the fastest time will be the first tonight to play for £1 million. Nice and quiet in the audience, please. Right, here comes the question. Put the nicknames of the current Spice Girls in alphabetical order. There is a sort of person coming into the show now who's saying, I will go for it. This is the closest I'll get in my life probably to having £1 million. And I want to be that person. Perry Poole in 4.55 seconds. Come on. That was very quick. That was very quick.
Thank you. Yeah.
I just want to come this way a second.
All right.
Yeah.
Where are these batteries, John?
I'll get you one. Yeah, I can have mine.
Did I just do that?
Yeah.
It wasn't somebody else.
No.
Got a clip on there.
Good well in there, Thanks, John.
Right.
Good girl. You said you would.
I said I'm going to £1 million, didn't I?
Yeah, you did. You can't disappoint us now.
This is worth £125,000. Take your time, Perry. Have a look at it. When Margaret Thatcher became a baroness, which name did she use in her title? Revo, Kesteven, Cheveley, Levine. You've got a 50-50. You're four questions away from £1 million. If you get this wrong, you've dropped £32,000.
Well, I have no idea. So I'm going to reduce the odds. I'll play the 50-50, please.
OK. Computer, take away two wrong answers, please. Leave Perry just the right answer and the one remaining wrong answer. Take your time. You've got £64,000. You can take it now. It's a lot of money.
Oh, I'll take the money. Don't ask me to change my mind.
I wouldn't.
I'll take the money.
You sure?
Yes. I want to go home.
It's a huge amount of money, but if you give me a right answer, it will be worth £125,000. You've got £64,000 at the moment.
Levine.
You can take a check.
D.
D. Levine. You can take the money.
Don't do this, Chris.
But I do
You're
it every night,
me.
Perry.
No, I'm going to go with D.
Final answer.
My final answer.
D. Levine.
Yeah.
You had £64,000 in your hand. It's the wrong answer. So sorry. It isn't. You've been such a great player. Oh, you are brilliant. Perry Paul still goes away with £32,000. Bless you, darling. You've been a brilliant contestant.
Thank you. Oh, that was great. I'm going to do it again. I'm sorry, I've covered him in makeup again.
Well done, Perry.
Thank you. Sorry, darling.
Did you know?
No,
I'm sorry, darling.
I'm sorry, darling.
I did. I was sure it was. I wanted to say,
oh, I don't care.
Bum.
I had a great time. I'm coming
again. Brilliant.
I'm coming again.
You can.
I am. I'm going
you really
to the phone. I've got till midnight.
She's got the phone now.
I'm going to go on the phone.
Oh, brilliant. 32,000, still a lot of money.
Thank
You're
you very
great
much
contestant.
Indeed. No, I've had a
Quite
great
ever so
time.
Mad, but great good day. Bless you, Andrew. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Give a big hand. Perry Paul with
I did wave, and it's terrible. The emotion inside, you're thinking, if I say no now, I'm going home with 64 grand. And the little voice in you says, yeah, but Perry, do you want to go home with 64 grand? Do you want to go home with 32,000 and achieve your goal? Or do you want to wimp out and go home with 64,000? And basically, well, I chose to try and achieve my goal, and I have no regrets.
I do think one of the things that we all work at very hard here, I mean, the researchers, the girls, do everybody do, is giving these people a really nice day. So the least we can do is say, thanks, you were a great contestant, or sorry you didn't do better, or sorry you didn't get in the chair, or fastest finger. And they all seem to. I mean, I haven't met anyone yet who said, actually, I really hated it. They all say, we have had such a great day. I know I didn't get on TV, or I know I was only on for 10 seconds, or I got on and made a bit of a fool of myself, but I had such a great day. And sure, I mean, I think it's essential I should be part of that. Of course I should thank them. I mean, I think it's the least I can do.
Well, you nearly persuaded me to take the 64,000. But I knew I had to gamble. I wanted to gamble. I decided before I came I was going to gamble. And if I'd gone home with 64 grand, I would have regretted
happy.
It.
You'd have been twice as happy.
No.
Okay, let's play Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? The next question's worth £2,000 to you. Here it comes. Which creature featured in a 1983 number one single for Culture Club?
Do you know that, Olivia?
Tiger. Crocodile. Chameleon. Seagull.
Time to take a chance. Do your face. Sea chameleon.
Not seagull?
No.
Final answer?
I wasn't sure.
That's right answer, you've got £2,000. Body the fat Labrador's little tail is wagging like a good one.
When we woke up yesterday morning, it was all very different, wasn't it? We were total VIPs, and we couldn't even sniff without somebody offering us a tissue. And we went through the whole day being very important. And this morning it was rather strange. No one recognised us. And they didn't know that we'd been on television. And you just feel like you want to wear your badge. And when I went into the supermarket this afternoon, I couldn't control myself. I was in a queue. And as I was putting my things on the thing, on the conveyor belt, I had to say to the woman, I'm celebrating. And she said, is it your birthday? I said, no, I'm on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire tonight. Are you going to watch it? She said, oh, let me have a look at your face. I'll see if I can recognise you. And I said, well, my name's Perry Poole. And she said, oh, all right. And I thought, well, it wasn't like that yesterday.
People's reactions, they don't treat me any different. What am I? I'm just a girl that went on a gun show and happened to win some money. I don't think, nothing like that would change me as a person. But I think that's something you'd have to ask people around me. I still think I'm me. I still look for bargains. I still like walking around the shops and buying a two-for-one offers. I'm still me. It's been lovely and I've done some wonderful things, as you say, being that so-called celebrity off the telly. But I'm just the mad one, really. I think that's what people have picked up on.
I want to be here the night that somebody sits in there and wins £1 million so much. It will be just a fantastic moment in my life. I mean, never forget it. It will be incredible.
He's won $1 million!
It's already happened in America. How long before it happens here?
The people who win the big money, they tend to come out of nowhere. And that's what will happen one night. I mean, that's where the millionaire will come out of nowhere. You know, you will not be sitting down thinking, this man is the brain of Britain, he's going to do whatever. It'll just be some guy or some lady who'll sit down. And we do this adventure together, probably over a couple of nights, and suddenly you think, my God, we're nearly there. It will be electric. I mean, everybody, the guys up in the box, whatever, I mean, they come around. When it gets to big money, I mean, they're all, like, screaming upstairs at the screens. Like, go, 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 say B. I mean, there's nothing like it. There is nothing on television, and most of the people involved in this have done it a very long time. There is nothing like this show. It's an extraordinary bloody thing.
Comedy from the turn of the millennium after the break in Dark Ages.